thing I should say, I'll put the mic on, I don't really need it. It has been suggested that in view of the weather, those who are wearing heavy clothes like jackets and things might wish to get rid of them. I'm certainly not keeping mine on, as you can see. And the ladies, of course, I'm sure they'll be comfortable. I believe we have some new members here, and so some new members are really all councillors will be members.
I'm just looking to the chair for
that's definitely not member of the Davis, is it? It's not. That's an empty space, you know. So it is your new district here, and I think otherwise we are all the same members. But first item on the agenda is to move the minutes. Will somebody move that they are ever active record?
I'm going to do that, Chair.
That's okay. And that is the concern. Well, I have been reminded that I should draw your attention to the members' code of conduct and any declarations of interest. Are there any declarations of interest?
Question first,
Jeff, okay.
Declarations of disinterest.
The solicitor advises me that we should also have like declarations of disinterest. I'm sure that would be good.
Chair, just as a kind of thing, I'm going to the middle. Okay. Just a little thing. My name is Chris. Was present. Thank you, Mabo. Isn't it? Doesn't appear to be a member this year. And I'm sure we'd like to pull our back of life. Our thanks to Chris for the contribution that she's made, I suppose, to all retiring members of this committee. The cycle and the changeover, I'm sure we'd like to pull our back of life. Thanks for their contribution.
I'm sure everybody would be happy. We all agree. Thank you. So the next item then is the highways maintenance contract. Mark, would you like to take the place? And go back. If I always take your photo.
Chair, thank you members. Thank you for inviting me to come along this evening to provide an update on the recommissioning of our highway services from October 2018. Members will recall that the key reason why I'm here this evening is that we had a lengthy debate at the last meeting, and based on the important high profile nature of these services and the importance of having a smooth transition in October, members are very keen to come back with a further report to talk about the procedures that we've put in place to ensure that proper transfer and that robust approach to managing those risks. So, just by way of background really, so I know that most or all of you will be familiar with the background of many of these services, which form a large part of the post bag for many of you as ward members on a day-to-day basis. So just as a recap then, we know that Wirral's highway network is the council's biggest asset. It consists of around 1,200 kilometres of road, which are currently managed by a strategic contract with BAMP or BAMP at all. The services that come under that contract at the moment are listed in section 3 and include things like carriageways, footways, drainage, street lighting, signs, road marking, bridges, structures, winter maintenance, things like that. In terms of how the contract works, as an important principle, essentially there are two kinds of work under the contract arrangement, and they're outlined in paragraph 3.2. So we have structural planned type work, so that is capital funded activities such as playing out resurfacing schemes or specialist surface treatments, and that work has traditionally been undertaken by specialist highway subcontractors in the highway industry, and that plays a really important role in helping us to achieve our overall highway condition performance indicators. In terms of the model of service delivery going forward, the intention is that we will continue with a series of commissions or contracts in place to deliver those arrangements. That will be carried out by the commercial management arm of the council, and that work is worth round about £4 million per year, and I'll come back to that later. In terms of the area that has been very much of interest to members, the other type of work in this that's covered by the contract is the routine, the active type work. So that's the day-to-day, usually revenue-funded activity, such as those pothole and street lighting repairs, traditionally undertaken by resources directly employed by the contractor without much trouble, and essentially enabling us to discharge our statutory responsibilities as highway authority. And in terms of the approach going forward, the plan is that there will be a new operational services set up within the delivery services arm of the council that will be responsible for delivering these. Actually, when we take account of various subcontract arrangements and arrangements to deliver that work effectively, we are talking about in the region of about £2 million a year's worth of work going through that direct delivery arrangement. So that's by way of background. Very much in response to the discussion at the last meeting, I draw members' attention to section 5, which is the real meat of this report, really. So what I've tried to do is to, under a series of themes, to really provide an update on exactly where we're at the moment in terms of that service mobilisation transfer process on the one until the 1st of October, and actually, in a very practical way, how we're managing some of those operational and key risks. And really what I'd like to do with your permission, Chair, is to just talk through each of those headings, talk around some of the issues, and hopefully give members an idea as to where we're at in terms of progress and those risks as we go through it. So, first of all, really, just to set the scene, so under the first section there, just a few comments around the management, governance and the assurance arrangements that we have in place. So as you'd expect for a project like this, the mobilisation process is being overseen by a project board. We have all of those key corporate disciplines around that table: HR, procurement, legal, finance, communications, etc. That board reports into the Corporate Investment and Change Board, and we also have Mark Gandy from our internal audit team sits on that board as well. What we're looking to do is, as I talk through these themes, is to, at that board, we've had this, we think we've got a robust approach to how we're managing and mitigating these operational risks. And the key point here is to ensure a smooth service transfer and business continuity when we get to the 1st of October. Just thinking in practice what that looks like, just a few points there in 5.1. So it does mean that from 0 hours on the 1st of October, obviously, we need to have that essential emergency call-out capability. So at 2 o'clock in the morning, if an incident takes place or there's a serious road traffic accident, etc., we need those arrangements in place from 0 1 hours of the 1st of October. But then during that first week that we go live, we will then want to make sure that within the first day, we need other essential reactive services up and running. And then during that first week, the rest of the routine, the active capability will be established and up and running from Prenton Depot from the 1st of October. Importantly, obviously I'm here tonight to focus on primarily around mobilisation, transfer and the risk management approach, but just to give you all comfort that certainly at the last meeting we had some broader questions around the highway service and how it's going to work and how it's going to perform. We did go to a meeting of the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee only a week or so ago to provide an overall update on the service and the arrangements and this mobilisation process as well. Just running through a number of themes then. So moving on to HR and staffing matters and health and safety. So we know, as we touched on last time, that round about 25 people who work for BAM are going to choose to transfer into the council. Obviously some of the key risks there around if we don't do this right and we don't do it effectively, we can end up with staff who are disengaged or they don't transfer properly or they decide not to, to come over to the council, etc. So there's a whole series of staffing risks there that are actually really important, and it's essential that we have robust processes in place to manage those. At the heart of this is all about communication and making sure that we do that effectively with those staff. So communication is absolutely key in this approach. Over the past months and since Christmas, we've had regular staff trade union briefings with those groups of staff, really just to take them through this process, understand their views and where they're at, and then really to make sure that cheaper transfer process goes as smoothly as possible. That's really coming to a critical phase now. We're doing lots of good work around this, but the week after next there will be a two-week process whereby we go into detailed one-to-ones with the individual members of the BAM staff, and that's where we're looking to really firm up on precise terms and conditions, deal with issues such as overtime and car allowance and things like that, and really just make sure that we close out that process in a smooth way, really. We've got a lot of support from HR through your colleagues in terms of taking that work forward. The other key part of this as well is making sure that we've gone through all the necessary steps in terms of health and safety training, risk assessments and things like that. I would say, Chair, that our colleagues in Balmuttal have been really, really helpful. They've essentially said that in terms of some of those operational those risk management processes, they've been really happy to share all of that kind of information in a very open and transparent way with the council for us to use and get the benefit from. So that's been a very positive process. So I think we're in good shape on that. And then there's also a very important risk around making sure that for the 1st of October, we need an operational staffing structure. We need that in place. But it's really important it's populated with all the people as well. So one of the things that we're planning for, hopefully it won't be the case, and hopefully all the operational people will move into the council and want to be part of the new service going forward. But we are making sure that we've got contingency arrangements in place if people change their mind very, very late on and decide not to come out to the council. So we're exploring those options at the moment. We're talking to employment agents and things like that to make sure that we will absolutely have all the people in the structure for the 1st of October. Moving swiftly on to the next work stream is around depot and premises and ICT and communications. Members will probably be aware that that BAM currently work out of the Prenton Depot. As a depot and facility, the land belongs to the council, but it's actually been leased by BAM over the past 4 years while they've been carrying out this contract on our behalf. The plan, and this is about mitigating and reducing those operational risks, the plan is to continue working out of Prenton Depot from the 1st of October. Lots of really good reasons for that. BAM have spent a lot of money and got a lot of improvements around security and CCTV, which make it a very, very robust depot. So in terms of having stocking equipment on site, that makes a lot of sense. It's a very, very central location, as you all know, straight off the M55. also, really importantly, staff will come into work on the 1st of October. They will now be working from the council, not that. But we're going to be familiar with the site, familiar with the location, and it's minimising that risk and uncertainty for them. Also, just as an aside, we're doing work around just making sure that all of the IT and all the Wi-Fi and systems like that are all in place. And importantly, what we are doing, even though we've got various corporate plans around rolling out new customer access systems and asset management systems and things like that, we're following the basic principle that for day one, we're looking at lift and shift. So we're looking at basically continuing to deliver the work using the CRM system, using the work ordering systems in exactly the same way as we are now to make sure that that runs smoothly for the 1st of October. And we will only look to transform the service and introduce those new IT systems after the 1st of October when everything's embedded and everything's running smoothly. So we're making sure that we don't take any risks around transferring changes in IT systems and things like that. Moving on to the next area, importantly, so this is about commissioned work. So as I said at the outset, there's two aspects to this really. So this is about the council making sure that we've got the commissioned or the contract arrangements in place. So the first part of this on page 20 of the report is to make sure that around about £4 million a year's worth of work that is delivered via commercial management. We need to make sure that we've got those contracts in place. You'll see a list on page 20 there of there's seven individual contract arrangements that we're looking to have that in place. We're looking to go out onto the chest and starting that supplier qualification process next week. And obviously we need to make sure those arrangements are in place. Out of all of that work, you'll be aware that certain kinds of contracts and certain kind of highway maintenance activities, it's a seasonal thing, but we actually don't do some of that, and we don't need to start some of it until the springtime. So we have got a bit of time, a bit of slack on some of those contracts, but at the same time, other ones are time critical. Members will be aware that we have a large programme, about £1 million a year, of highway and traffic improvements, integrated transport schemes. It would include the kind of schemes that we used to do through the Institute of Committees and things like that. And there's actually quite a lot of work that we need to commission from the 1st of October and get done during the financial year. So there's quite a lot of work to do. The second aspect of contract arrangements is that even though in delivery services a large amount of that work we're doing ourselves with our own people, it will be necessary for us to have what we call subcontract type arrangements in place to give us flexibility and make sure we can deliver all of that. So on page 21 you'll see a table there with three headings. So there's three types of work where we're looking to put in place subcontract arrangements for an 18-month period. Because of the relatively modest value, we're looking at going through the construction line framework process. So the beauty of construction line is that firms will have already been through a quality process to get onto that approval list. So we're looking at using the benefits of that. The other benefit of the construction line process as well is that we're very, very keen that we get a nice balance of some of the bigger firms, but also some of the smaller firms and very much local rural firms as well. So we're very keen to encourage that local market and local firms to want to do business with the council. In terms of managing some of those risks, you'll see there that we've had procurement colleagues on the board. We've had a number of stock market testing events, and we've been talking to other councils as well to learn some of the lessons there, and I'll come to this from that later. And then just very briefly, Chair, just the remaining two themes. So plant equipment and vehicles. So again, reducing some of those operational risks around plant and equipment, largely an approach that at the moment tend to hire on an ad hoc basis most of the plant and equipment that they need. We're looking at following the the same kind of approach. And then in relation to vehicles, there are a couple of specialist vehicles which if we can't get hold of those, it just presents us with operational risks. So starting with David Armstrong's support as well, we've looked to make decisions around just taking that risk out and actually let's purchase some of those specialist vehicles that we need to ensure we can do street lighting repairs and gully cleansing as well. So we've reduced some of those operational risks that way. And then finally, we're just in a piece of work about looking at vehicles and whether we go with a lease or a capital purchase option. So we're looking to close out on that in the next week or so. And then finally, just in terms of the stock of materials, again, taking out some of those risks. Again, working with David's support, we've said, you know what, we don't want to find ourselves on the 1st of October and find out that we're running out of some of this key stock and key materials. So we're working with that and we're making sure that we've got a 3 month stock supply in there at the depot and we can actually just pay, you know, then purchase that stock from that and take out that risk. So thank you for your time, Chairman, for just allowing me to walk through some of that detail. I think importantly, just in terms of an overall assessment of risk, and I think from a personal view where I think that's at the moment, I've alluded to some of this in the report, running through some of those themes, I think the positive is that actually, in terms of those things that we can directly control for the 1st of October, the HR and the staffing issues, the depot, the premises, the IT comms, all of that work around the plant equipment and vehicles, the stock, I actually think we're in really, really good shape. I've got a very high degree of confidence and expecting things to run smoothly for the 1st of October. And we've done a lot of work to actually significantly minimise those risks, I think. So I've got a high degree of confidence with those. I think the one area where I think we're just keeping a close eye on. So I think overall we're in good shape, but if we talk about the Commission's work there, clearly, whereas some things are very directly under our control, we are still subject to having to go out to the market and relying on the market being interested and wanting to bid and providing you know, attractive tenders and bidding for that work. So there's just a slight higher degree of just uncertainty there. As I've put there at the bottom of page 21, we've done everything we can around that. As I say, we've engaged with the market, we've talked to Navy FRT, we've done what we can that day. But obviously I think we'll all be sleeping more comfortable in a few weeks' time when we've got through that process. We've got the tenders in and we've awarded the contracts and so on.
Thank you, Mark. I think it's obvious that this is one of the most significant changes in personal medicine in a very long time. Thank you for your report. I'm sure there'll be lots of questions. I think I've had the first one.
On the part of the contracts that you're going to be sending out, like the ones that you're going to will the bank that's already involved in any of those contracts? Yes, or 10? Or are they on the list of 13?
As far as we're aware, the smaller scales work via construction lines, so I don't necessarily think about a part of that. It is the case that when we go out for the larger scale planned structural work, so that list there of 7 contracts that are actually going to, in the region, of about £4 million a year, clearly BAM will have the opportunity to go through that process and try and bid and compete for that work. So importantly, they have no right or no call over that work as of now, so that relationship between BAM and the council has ended. But clearly, if they wish to participate in that supplier qualification process and compete against everybody else for any of those contracts, along with the firm, they would be within their rights to do so.
Well, obviously, the whole reason we took this in-house is because the inadequate way that Alvin Lutzel had been conducting the contract. And see how they can be on the preferred list of bidders, having done such a bad job in the first place, and we don't expect them to do such a good job on small contracts. £4 million wouldn't save them because they're very small.
Okay, so obviously we're in a public arena, Chair, so in terms of views about VAM's performance, we may be getting into commercial and other territories. So, but in terms of answering your question, so VAM have been carrying out a strategic highway maintenance contract for the council today, and people will have their views around the performance and how well VAM's gone. Going forward, the list of seven contract types there, that is specific types of work and specific products of work. But as I say, very importantly, they're not on an approved list already. That supplier qualification stage that we're looking to go out for most likely next week, that's just going out onto the chest, any company at all being allowed to put a quality submission in and say, can I go to the next stage and be allowed to bid for this work? And we treat them the same as everybody else. We look at their company status, the financial standing, the references, the quality, everything, before making a decision as to whether they are allowed to then bid for the work. So at the moment, they don't have any status and not any preferred list.
Okay, thanks.
We're
on next. Then Jeff.
Can I thank you, Mark, for the comprehensive report? Just a couple of things I'd like to just raise. Do we have a copy of the standard structure going forward at some stage? This little structure is you outlined. And also, I think it's been touched on one as well in the week. The problem is the fertility of the market and whether the pricing comes back in to satisfy the council. And irrespective of that, the band performance or not performance, whichever one you prefer to use, the issue is that we've now took it back in-house. With our own in-house team, for the potential bidders, or are they, because they are not skilled to do that, would they not be allowed to bid? It's not clear on that. I know it separates the two, and we will be doing this as an in-house team, but a lot of the other stuff the band did would have been done with the same type of operators, would it not?
Through you, Chair, the planned structural type work, those seven contracts on page 20, so interestingly that work has always been delivered by the external market, by the highways industry. So even going back to before 2009, we used to do certain kinds of reactive day-to-day works ourselves. But that list of seven contracts there, it's the major playing out these services schemes. So some of the big firms in the industry have got a great reputation, your Hansons, your Tarmacs, the firms like that. It's only those firms that can do that work for us. So local authorities don't have the size or the economies of scale to do that work. So all local authorities around the country, we all use those big firms in the highways industry to do that kind of work for us, and it will be the same way going forward. What I would say though is that there are some areas whereby in that routine reactive work actually comes to about £2 million a year. At the moment, the way that VAM deliver that is some of it is delivered directly using their or our own people, and they are using subcontractors. Now, certainly over time, once we've brought this in from the 1st of October, I'm sure all members, we will be looking at all those processes, how we're doing things. We've had lots of suggestions around innovation and good practice and lots of ideas, and we're going to be looking very seriously at that kind of work, doing it with our own people in new and innovative ways. And I'm getting lots of suggestions on a regular basis from members and the public about ideas and things that we can be looking at. So the priority at the moment is just to make sure that the transfer goes smoothly, and let's get this brought in for the 1st of October, and then from then on, it's then about transformation, modernising, and really looking to take that service where we can.
Thank you.
united with the church and really a flame and now the nice combination going on.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. So we've got a without getting into too much detail from a HR point of view, but we have a mix of a number of senior people, a number of QSs, a number of supervisory staff, and a number of operational people as well. So that 25 consists of a mix of all of those. From the work that we're doing on the run-up to the detailed one-to-one meetings, we're working up to see what the terms and conditions and those detailed conditions for the BAM staff, all 25, look like at the moment, and what that would look like when they come over to the council and whether that's comparable or not, and taking account of things like pensions and sick pay and things like that. From the work that we've done, I'm certainly confident in the view that I would expect a large proportion of those people, I think as a council we've got a good offer, and I think people are going to want to come and transfer and they're going to want to work for us.
Thank you. Thank you, Chair. Thank you for the report, because it was, there was general concern around the committee about the way this had been done, so it came out through a cabinet member action on what was a really major area of concern for our residents, and also for our concern was around the assurance that we were going to actually follow the proper human rules, and we had followed proper human rules, and that we were also going to make sure that this was going to provide value for money. So I'm not going to try and second guess how things will be operated, and certainly in terms of the risks around doing it. So thank you for the report, which does go through in some depth the approach. I'm also pleased to see that it's a kind of balanced approach that's being taken. So there was a view initially was that everything was going to be brought in, and wasn't really going to have the right skills to deliver this. And I think you did say at one point that you will be looking at stabilising the arrangements and then looking at future options and abilities to innovate. So from all those areas, I think that's really good, and it's a very important report. And I'm sure you covered off how things will operate with the Environment Screening Committee. So I think the question for me, and this is the one kind of next continual risk in my mind, although I'm really impressed with the project management approach and the work streams and how the inclusion of all the colleagues and procurement colleagues, etc., is we're moving, in effect, from one contract that it can be argued one way or the other, it wasn't managed particularly well, or really well, or however you want to do it, as a conscious way. So there is an issue around moving from having the contract management capability and capacity to manage one contract to us now taking on the responsibility of contract management, compliance, performance management of those. I think my council 10 according to this, although with the additional summaries that we talked about, it might actually be more. So I think the risk for me, and I'm presuming this has been identified, is having that capability and capacity to manage the transition, but then the ongoing management of that. And I suppose one question would be, what are we doing to mitigate that particular risk, ensuring that we maintain appropriate levels of governance and contract compliance and so on?
Okay, thank you. It is a very pertinent point. It's a very pertinent issue. So we need to make sure that operationally we've got that transfer to take place on the 1st of October, and that's gone smoothly. At that point in time when that's happened, we will have an operational arm function in delivery services. We will also have client and supervisory teams within the council. And one of the things that we need to do once we've actually got this service in is to work through and make sure that we've got that robust contract management function right. At the moment, David and I are still in discussions and we're still doing some work behind the scenes on this, but this is about looking at the, you know, that kind of middle management structure in the council and in delivery services, looking at those commercial management and contract supervision functions and how we carry out the work and just taking stock of all that and making sure that we've got that right. But we've got some opportunities because if we think about the fact that at the moment we have a separate client team of inspectors and those people carrying out those functions, but then we've also got people, some of the supervisors that are sat working in that now, so they were supervising those subcontractor engines. So we're going to be pulling BAM supervisor resource, who used to spend a lot of their time supervising contracts and works, into the council alongside our highway inspectors and supervision resource as well. So, you know, there's a significant opportunity there. We just need to work that through. So I'm confident that we'll have robust arrangements in place, but it is fair to say at this stage that it's about making sure that we get the operation up and running properly for the 1st of October. And we will do further work around that, and that will be part of this overall piece around transforming the service over the next 6-12 months.
We've just done a little bit of the training this afternoon, and one of the things that the trainer was telling us about is avoid people, officers who come in and say, trust me, because we need to be a little bit more rigorous than that. And so, I can understand the emphasis being on, you know, the 1st of October, you know, that sort of the cutover and the cutover working well, and we need to maintain that. But we are talking about a series of major contracts here with ongoing subcontractors. And I think we really need to have a plan in the run-up to October and then business as usual post-October of how we're going, if we accept clients and supervisory have had issues with a one contract and it could be contended there have been issues with in other areas, that whole thing about how we manage contracts, but that's an issue. And what I want to see is as much of the money that we spend on road payment not brought into a convoluted or conflated area to manage the fact that we don't have the capability and capacity, so we need the right people with the right skills to do the right job in the right way. And that continues to be an area of concern, and that doesn't necessarily have to be this committee, but I would certainly welcome some reassurance around what that structure is going to be, what the capability and capacity of that structure will be to manage, as I said, 10 contracts instead of one. And also anyone coming across from the previous provider of the services, what plans may be in place to make sure that they are aware of the different arrangements, and they are different from the private sector because we operate in a private sector way, to a public organisation operating on, you know, the key principles around, you know, fiduciary responsibilities, compliance, openness, transparency, fair competition, so on. So, it's an area I would like to explore some more at some point. The risk, not the operational management, but the risk of that, and get some assurance that you've got the right things in place. So, but key with all that, so it's a really good report, and it does provide a degree of assurance and reassurance to people that we're going in the right direction.
That was the question, was Jeff, that was a comment.
I think the question, that part of it,
No, I think very pertinent points, which I think we note. I think one thing I would stage, so just looking across the table to my colleague Mike Lane, is that we have talked about this issue, haven't we, Mike, about the about that post-transfer, around the fact that the risk profile of the service will have changed, and we need to be cognizant of that, and we need to make sure we can work around that. So if in your report, so you'll see 9.3 there, that reference to that principle of risk management post October. But I think Council will be very open to point comments that we need to make sure we're mindful of them. Thank you.
Thank you. My question was in relation to section 5.2 around staffing. So you've obviously given us a bit of a time scale to say that list will be coming to you very soon, and your backup plan is that you would kind of go to an agency. I suppose what I wanted to ask was how long would it take us to kind of engage those temporary staff to get hold of them, and to make sure they were inducted, if you like, that we're going to have any, I suppose what I want to make sure is that we don't have any gaps in that kind of early handling period.
Okay, thank you through you, Chair. Again, on a very personal point, so as part of that tutor transfer process, so the obligation on the TUPIC is that we have a clear understanding from them and from the workforce. I think we've got until usually about 28 days before transfers in Africa. So I know members of the table are very familiar with many of these processes. So despite that, so I think first of all, them have been sharing information as we've gone along. So they've been very supportive and transparent. They've been sharing that work information. But obviously, aside of that 28 days, I think we do need to be in a position where, even when the 28 days have gone, still based on human nature, etc., some of those operation employees who will probably be only on relatively small notice period could actually pull out very, very late. So at an operational level, we will be looking to make sure that there is an arrangement in place with an agency or with another agency, such as a authority or whatever, to provide people at very short notice, such as a week's notice or something like that. I think as we go up the structure to the supervisory positions, it's a bit easier. We've got a degree of confidence, I think, by the 28 days, and I'm not sure we'll know where we're at.
Chair, can I just add the second goal here? Mark and I met the staff. Quite a number of these people worked at the council originally before we went to follow us and went to the bar. But they were really in another meeting which was in the positive.
Chris, I agree with this. That would have all my questions have been answered. Thank you. David.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Thanks again, Mark, for a very comprehensive and detailed report. The one thing that appears to be missing, unless I've missed it, is any mention of quality control. I think I'm not unique in other members of the committee and other 66 members of the council in saying an awful lot of the problems over the last few years, or my post-bac particularly, has been full of the odd niggles, or stronger niggles, or detailed niggles, about the quality and performance of what